That's great. It starts with an earthquake. Birds and snakes and aeroplanes, and Lenny Bruce is not afraid. It's the end of the world as we know it, and I feel fine. Fine enough to make up this list of movies for you to keep your mind otherwise occupied while the world churns relentlessly outside your window. It's hard to imagine what might happen next, but you can be glad that none of the scenarios from these movies are currently playing out. Hello, horror heads, and welcome back to the scariest channel on YouTube, Top 5 Scary Videos. I'm your horror host, Keegan Hughes, and today we are counting down the top 5 scary end of the world horror movies. Light a candle, light a motive, and call Bernstein, because we're about to enter the eye of a hurricane. Before getting started, make sure to give this video a big thumbs up and subscribe for more turbulent tales. Outstanding, let's get going. Shambling in at number 5, we've got Dawn of the Dead. We can look at Romero's or Snyder's version here, they're both quite good. However, I am a sucker for the classics, so we'll delve deeper into the classic 70s zombie flick. A follow-up to 1968's Night of the Living Dead, we're thrust into that same world somewhere down the line. The zombie virus has spread, and the flick is much larger in scale than its predecessor. 3 weeks after the outbreak, we find out that millions have died and been reanimated. Large parts of society have been replaced with the undead. All in all, humanity has collapsed. It's rough. However, it also gave birth to one of the most iconic, comfiest zombie outbreak shelters of all time, a shopping mall. Oh hell yeah. Who wouldn't want to be trapped in a gigantic showroom for all things stylish and deadly? Grab a pair of ski poles, tie some ice skates to the end, and then grab a Cinnabon to celebrate your fantastic new zombie killer. It's just a great time. Dawn of the Dead is a quality mix of action, horror, and comedy with additional excellent gut-squishing gore. There are just so many iconic bits in this flick. The basement full of zombies, people being torn into like fleshy cherry pies, biker gangs taking over as the powers that be. This was a big thing in 70s movies, eh? That and not trusting the military and the police and the useless government to help out. The everyman, taking over and using violence as a way of staying safe and keeping autonomy. Huh, I wonder if that'll make a comeback. We got this, man. We got this by the ass. Coming in at number 4, The World's End. When the world seems like it's devoid of meaning, start with a good old fashioned pub crawl and end with a blue goo-filled alien completely taking over the world, and still manage to goof it up. This cap to the Cornetto trilogy is equal parts funny, poignant, and terrifying. Where the first two flicks saw a zombie plague conquered and a small town cult shut down, The World's End really does end the world. We're not really sure how or why until the end though, so spoilers. In among all of the Edgar Wright visual gags we've come to know and love, we find a group of good pals from way back in the day. The boys, the lads, but like 20 years later, trapped in the muck and mire that is adult living. Once at the top of the world, these fellows are experiencing midlife in the worst possible way. Existential crises abound, unfulfilled in all sorts of sorts. They can't see the way their friends remain low though, as they're all experiencing different types of problems. Romantic issues, career standstills, general aspirations being dashed upon the rocks. Classic life. We've all been there. Honestly, it's kind of like if It Part 2 got its adult characters right, and if they didn't spend 2.5 hours doing what could have been done in a much shorter time frame. Well, what better way to get over a slump and feel like yourself again than by fighting off an alien invasion all while pounding beers in your hometown? So, how is all this dealt with? They can't keep fighting forever. The characters are forced to reckon with some heady questions, ones you might have to reckon with some sunny day. Is it worth it to be replaced? What do you gain or lose by pushing forward? What constitutes a fulfilling life? Does alcohol really solve all your problems? That last one hits home especially hard. It's a wicked movie with some scary overtones, and the way I see it, it lands on this theme. The only life worth living is a post-apocalyptic one. No modern dullness, no societal expectations, just you and your truest way of being. Are you ready for something like that? Coming in at number 3, we've got Invasion of the Body Snatchers. The 70s version. A remake of the 1956 movie based on a 1955 novel, and somehow this 1978 movie is just as relevant today. Humans being replaced by aliens. Aliens who have no concept of what it is to be human. Biologically perfect, but entirely lacking human emotion. Flying down to Earth in lovely pink flower pods, attractive to any and all who see them. Hollowing out the original humans, taking over their duties, making their existence soulless and efficient. What does this sound like to you? Modern neoliberal society? Late stage capitalism? Maybe I'm digging too deep here. Well, back to the plot. The pod people eventually do want to take over the world, and they will do so quietly. They're ruthlessly efficient at this, and by the time some smart folks figure out what's happening, it is too late. Major players have already been assimilated. Reporting the issues is a fool's game. The government's already converted. They act in the interest of the pod people now. The police and the military, too. Try telling them that pod people are a danger to society at large. It is a hopeless, bleak movie. Fighting is hardly effective, and the damage is pretty much already done. The main characters, as hard as they try, are playing checkers against a chess master here. Every step they take to prevent the annihilation and replacement of humanity is just a drop of water in an ocean. Another existentially scary movie about the end of the world. I guess apocalyptic visions tend to cause existential dread, huh? Plus, the aliens do that pod people point and screech when they see someone non-assimilated, and that's pretty freaky. And there's a dog with a human face. Scares the socks off you, for real. Swinging into number two, we've got Children of Men. It still blows my mind that Alfonso Cuarón managed to direct this, Roma, Harry Potter and the Prisoner of Azkaban, Gravity, and Y Tu Mama Tambien. The man is a genius, a filmmaker extraordinaire. Give him the resources and he will make a fantastic flick, no doubt. The cinematography in here is top notch. It's famous for its one takes and realistic newsreel style. Children of Men is a sight to behold and presents lots of compelling ideas to turn over in your head for ages. Okay, enough cinephile rambling on and on to the end of the world. In Children of Men, human infertility is absolutely destroying birth rates. Society's crumbling and humanity is facing extinction. Of course, this makes everyone very testy and a whole lot of wild fighting occurs. The UK has one of the remaining functioning governments and as such is seeing a huge influx of refugees. Folks are trying to escape the radiation and plague that have rendered the rest of the world basically unlivable. In light of these new developments, the once democratic nation becomes a police state and enacts martial law. Hell, they even kill a bunch of immigrants to prove a point. This does not sit well with a whole slew of insurgent groups, leading to plenty of extra combat. In among all this chaos, a young immigrant woman is found to be pregnant. Now, instead of immediately taking her to safety and studying her for the good of humanity, she's bounced around and exploited for political gain. Veiled references to modern and historical events are sprinkled throughout, and the anti-immigration sentiment feels especially important now. Themes of faith are front and center here, focusing on the people struggling for a better future, even if they themselves won't get to see it. This is an important idea to consider in the face of world-changing circumstances. In fact, Cuarón addressed this head-on in an interview once. He claimed to have left the movie open-ended in order to let the audience decide whether it was bleak or hopeful. If you can fight for something and die while doing so, is that a worthy sacrifice or a foolish loss of life? Watch this movie, see the end of the world, and find out where you stand. And finally, at number one, No Blade of Grass. This 70s sci-fi classic doesn't feel too far flung. There are no high-tech billboards or laser-based weapons or alien robots relaxing amongst the criminals. Nope, it feels more like speculative fiction than anything. A fictional London has been overwhelmed by a plague, and it's not just London either. The whole world is experiencing a food shortage thanks to a disease that affects all members of the grass family. Food riots, global famine, some countries executing their own citizens in a desperate bid for survival, things are looking bleak. Cannibalism, anarchy, roving bands of motorcycle riding bandits. It's the moment before the apocalypse and people are getting nervous. The plot follows a family attempting to reach their uncle's farm for safety and food. Their escape to the countryside soon transforms into a fight tooth and nail for survival. The world presented in No Blade of Grass is a viscerally violent one. Bloodshed and savagery aren't played for laughs or for choreographed fight scenes. What we see is unspeakable deeds being performed at the edge of civilized society. This is not a world anyone wants to live in. There is no satisfaction or chivalry. Innocence is wiped away and despair and anguish take over. The breakdown of society is seen through many different eyes, too. Children, the upper class, poverty-stricken folks, starry-eyed lovers. It isn't pretty, no matter how you look at it. In the end, No Blade of Grass paints a picture of the least heroic kind of apocalypse. Likely the most accurate, too. People jettison their values and take what they can get, however they can get it. It's an indictment of the fragile social contracts that folks so desperately believe in, as well as a look at the general ineptitude of world governments and militaries when faced with such a disaster. To act in a way that benefits yourself is easy. To act in a way that helps many is hard. In the words of Roger Whittaker, "We circled Mars and we walked the moon. We reached the stars, or one day very soon. But no blade of grass here and no blue above. No, you and me, it's the end of life." Was that too heavy of a note to end on? We are talking about the end of the world, right? What did you think of the list? Which apocalyptic flicks do it best? Do we count disaster movies for lists like this? Make sure you let me know down in the comments. Speaking of comments, let's take a look at some of your more fragrant ones from the top 5 scary ask Reddit stories you need to read. JackSoccer101 says, I kinda wanna hear his legendary story. Maybe someday. Too long-winded for the comments section, unfortunately. Lock the Fox says, Keegan thought he would quench his thirst, but he shall drink no more. For what he thought was H2O was H2SO4. An excellent limerick, and you're right, sulfuric acid probably would be much worse than hydrochloric. Oogie's Ragdoll says, Ask Reddit has replaced Yahoo Answers for entertainment. Oh, Yahoo Answers. Whatever happened to you? I feel like the last big thing to come out of there was the whole Pergonent thing. Keith Borgolthaus says, so are you just going to the thrift shop for shirts, or is this a sign of the victims you have gathered? Definitely the thrift shop. Nothing shady going on here, no sir. And Isis Blackfeather says, Keegan, what is your Twitter? I tried K33GAN when you started here and it did not work. I don't actually have a personal Twitter. Someone else took K33GAN on there, so I'm sticking to Instagram for now. That's all the time we have for today. Before I insert a light bulb past my teeth and try to pull it out, make sure to give this video a big thumbs up and subscribe for more end time good times. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.